सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवा वहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहैः। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। हरि ओम श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः। हरि ओम। वसुदेव सुतं देवं कंसचाणूरमर्दनं देवकी परमानंदं कृष्णं वंदे जगद्गुरुं कृष्णं वंदे जगद्गुरुं। सो वी ऑन चैप्टर 9 एंड टुडे विल बी डूइंग वर्स 19 एंड द लास्ट टू वर्सेस। Krishna Bhagwan, there were very, very beautiful verses. He talked about who he is in more detail. And he said, I'm the father of this world and the mother and the sustainer and the grandfather. And one thing to be known or something worth knowing. And then purifier, the syllable Om. And also all the Vedas, the Rig, Sama, and Yajur, and Atharva also. And then in the next verse, 18, he says, this is also a very beautiful verse. He says, I'm the goal, the supporter, the Lord, the witness, the abode, the shelter, the friend, the origin, the dissolution, the foundation, and the treasure house, and the seed imperishable. And yeah. I was saying that how we need to literally memorize these two verses. Very good for meditation also. And now he goes a little more subtle. Because now, you know, those were a little bit easier to understand what he said. And today's verse is going much, much deeper. And so we have to be ready for it, what he's trying to say. We'll try our best to understand what he's saying. So this verse is, तपाम्यहम् अहम् वर्षम् निग्रुह निग्रु सॉरी दिस इज लिटिल बिट डिफिकल्ट आई ट्राई निग्रुह्णाम्युसृजाम्यहम् निग्रुह्णाम्युसृजामि च आई स्टार्ट ओवर अगेन तपाम्यहम् अहम् वर्षम् निग्रुह्णाम्युसृजामि च अमृतम् चैव मृत्युश्च सदसच्चाहम् अर्जुन। सो तपामि गिव हीट अहम आय अहम इज अगेन आय वर्षम इज रेन वर्षा जिसको बोलते हैं निगृह्यामि सच अ डिफिकल्ट वर्ड टू से फॉर मी विद होल्ड निग्रह करना मीन्स उसको होल्ड करना उत्सृजामि एंड दिस इज लाइक सेंड फोर्थ उसको होल्ड करना या भेजना दैट्स व्हाट हिंदी में बोलेंगे च इज एन अमृतम इमोर्टैलिटी हम लोग को पता है ना अमृत सो उसका डीपर थोड़ा मीनिंग होएगा च इज एन एव इज ऑल्सो मृत्यु वी ऑल नो डेथ च इज एन सत इज एग्जिस्टेंस एंड असत इज नॉन एग्जिस्टेंस एंड वेरी इंटरेस्टिंगली दीज two words, existence and non-existence, we are going to be studying in Taittiriya Upanishad also. So it always synergizes both of them somehow with God's grace. Cha is and, aham is again I, Arjuna. So here Bhagwan is saying in a little more subtle way how he manages this whole universe. So he's the one who controls and takes care of the entire world. And even little things. It may look little, but actually the significance is very big. And all the little things also happen, or big thing also happen by his blessing only. You know, जैसे हिंदी में एक कहावत है ना कि भगवान की मर्जी के बिना पत्ता भी नहीं हिलता हमने सब सुना है ये सो ना भी समझ में आएगा क्या कैसे वो करते हैं ओके सो देन ही गिव्स अ फ्यू एग्जाम्पल टू फॉर दिस पॉइंट दैट यू नो देन ही सेज तपामि अहम आई अलोन क्रिएट द हीट इन द वर्ल्ड। Okay. So what is heat? What they are talking about is a much more subtler thing that without this heat, we cannot survive. And the heat is coming from the sun. And where is sun coming from? Him only. So by becoming as though he alone has become the sun and he gives the heat on the earth. So this is one way we can understand it. And you know, everybody knows the Gayatri Mantra, such a famous mantra. Usme bhi wo Surya ki upasana ki gayi hai. Surya ko Bhagwan ke roop mein dekha gaya hai, because it is coming from there only, you know. This Om Bhur Bhua that we always say. So our life on earth is possible because of the sun. Scientifically also, nobody can deny that. And then, so here we have to look at the sun as a great symbol of that Lord or Paramatma. So now, just scientifically think about it, that how the earth is placed in the right distance from the sun. Woh thoda bhi dur hoti ya pass hoti, life was not possible. And that's why we have, like, you know, other 9 planets or 8 planets in the solar system. None of them have life on it. Only Earth does. At least the life that we understand, you know, in our form, or the animals and the, you know, trees and all that. So that is possible because, so who is doing all that? We have to be thinking about that. And so, and then going a little deeper into it, when the statement he made that I am the one who give heat in this, because without heat and light, life is not possible, you know. And then to sustain the energy also, life to come up and to sustain, and that everything is obtained from the sun, directly or indirectly. Somebody will say, oh, I'm putting this light bulb on, and or, you know, battery, this, that, but energy is coming from the sun only. And scientifically also, this is known. Okay? And the food that we eat to sustain. Without sunlight, we cannot have food. We know that. We need, you know, water, sunlight, and soil. So all that is coming from God only. So that this is how we have to see. So it's Bhagwan's grace behind everything. Okay. And then he says another very interesting thing. That's also very deep, because you have to, a lot of contemplation is required. He says that Varsham Nigruhani and Utsrujami. So I give the rain and I hold it back also. Why did he say that? Because he's saying that when the rain happens, you know, that also is a grace of God. And then the weather turns hot and all that. So monsoon season, you can call Mumbai mein monsoon hota hai. Yahan par to it rains, like, I think in the winter, around winter time over here, right? It starts raining. It doesn't matter. It is because of the change of weather it happens. And the change of weather also, it's controlled by that holding heat and giving heat also. Think about it. You know, that uska jo difference hota hai, usi se rain ka bhi connection hai, you know. So he's saying that some people might say, no, you know, rain happens because of condensation and evaporation. All that is great. But, you know, what is the subtle truth behind all these things? Condensation and all these things. That's what we need to see. So he's saying that when we observe the world, we can give all the scientific explanation. So it doesn't mean that we really know what is behind it. So he was just, Nikhilananji was just saying that scientists tell us what they see, you know, or through our senses, what we infer and all that. That's it. But wo kyon hota hai? What is the cause of all that? Even scientists don't know. If you say material scientists, you know, a lot of scientists, they do believe in God. You know, my husband is one of the example. He's a scientist, but he also believes in God. But in the physical world, you focus only on what you observe and how it happens. But why it happens and what is the cause? That's a different ballgame, you know. So because there is water also behaves in a particular way, and scientists don't know why. Or why the sugar is sweet, you know. They know it is sweet. So that's how we have to see, go deeper into it. So he was just saying that in nutshell, the science may explain a lot of things, but divinity is there, and the spiritual spark is there in everything, including us, which is not understood by the physical scientists, you know, and not appreciated many times by science. But things are slowly changing now. They are doing consciousness studies and all that. So what we are understanding from this, that God alone creates different seasons by heat and by giving rain and drying it up, you know, or holding rain. So this is what is. So consider it blessing and grace of God. And he was explaining this, that this is the vision of the bhakta or jnani. He understands this, that, you know, there is this ultimate reality. In the end, that is the one responsible for everything. Because he's saying that when we look at the world and look at the subtler parts of it, then we start understanding that there is a power behind everything, you know. And even he was saying about life, you know, when, say, a child is born, the child is alive. And, you know, how to define that life, sometimes it's not that easy. The life is manifesting, you know, but this is how we learn slowly that how it's coming up. So, and another way of looking at it, that Bhagwan is the one expressing in various things in the universe, okay? And then he goes another subtle, very subtle point he talks about. He says, I am Amrutam, and also I am Mrityu. So there are two opposite things, right? So this, both the Swamis, they explained it in their own way, and both are very significant. When we go to Chinmayananji, always go the deepest level. Okay, so when we read the commentary, we'll go to that deepest level, what it means. But even chalo, whatever we understand about Amrit, jo bhi puranik stories vagara mein hota na ki wo Amrit ka pyala hai aur wo devtaon ne pi ke wo amar ho gaye. What does amar mean in their language? Very long life. Because devta ka bhi permanent nahi hai, wo humne padh sikh liya. So let's say amar means unki, they are immortal in some ways, long life samjho, huh? So then main wo amrit bhi hu, and then he says main mrityu bhi hu. That is a very, very important thing, because Bhagwan is saying that I'm life and death both. So we have to respect both equally, because they both belong to God. And another way of looking at it, that other way of looking at it is very easy. That there is nothing in this world that is devoid of God. You know? So that but then when moment, you know, Amrit or Mrityu aati hai, to sab Mrityu ko kuch negative way mein sochna shuru kar dete hain. Then, so we don't want to do that, because both belong to Him only. So this is, Nikhilananji was saying, this kind of thing has to be contemplated upon again and again, and keeping in mind that everything is divine, and don't look at death as a negative thing. And then he also reminded us that in our Puranic stories and all, you know Shiv Bhagwan. So, wo babushan pehnte hain, you know, snake wagar ka, aur also kabhi aapne dekha hai, mund mala bhi pehnte hain. You know, ek skull ka ki mala pehn lete hain, Shiv ji. It's a lot of pictures you will see. And Mahakali to hamesha pehnti hai. So, he's saying that to show, because Shiv Bhagwan is a call. Shiv means auspicious. The word is called Nami. Wo bhi mund mala pehnte hain, because we don't want to look at death as a negative thing. And then that is a very famous thing that he puts vibhuti on his body. And a lot of people may know, may not know, where is that vibhuti coming from? It's coming from cremation grounds. And actually that Mahakal Mandir in Ujjain, they 4 a.m. they have vibhuti ki wo kya bolte hain, bhasma aarti bolte hain usko. I don't know if any one of you have attended. I've gone to that mandir, but I have not attended that particular aarti, which happens at 4 a.m. And they actually bring the ashes from the cremation grounds, and they do pura abhishek on that. Mahakal means he's beyond time, beyond death, beyond everything, but he represents this, you know, that death is not a bad thing. So it's a very contemplative subject, you know. So that's, he was just reminding that life as well as death is expression of God. And then he, if you thoda bhi hum log vichar karenge, so pata chalega ki death is actually is just the death of the body. We know that we are immortal, right? And what, so that's what we have to churn upon. That all it means is that in this earth, life is gone, but it's there somewhere else. So when somebody dies, that person is not suddenly finished. Hum log bolte na, English mein bhi language mein hai, oh, that person passed away, right? They don't say he's finished or something, you know. So passed away. So even other languages, they have the same thing, you know. Or swargvas ho gaya uska. We have so many different words about it. Because there is a Swamiji, Chinmayananji, you know, he said, every body dies, but nobody dies. You know that Meena ji has heard this. Nobody, and because we all are immortal, we have just taken another birth, or we are in another loka. So what does death mean? Just leaving this body and taking another. That's all it is. And then he was just reminding us that we read in chapter 2, and we talked about all that. Krishna Bhagavan talked in detail about how body is like changing clothes. That's all. He compared it to changing clothes. That, hey, my clothes got worn out, and then I wear another one, and I don't worry about jo phate hue kapde, I just discard it. The same way the body is like a clothes that the soul discards and takes another one. And then he actually went another angle, which was very interesting. He's saying, you know, we also change clothes for different occasions, right? कि भाई मेरे को यहाँ जाना है तो मैंने ये को ये कपड़े पहनने हैं वो कपड़े पहनने हैं. तो he was comparing taking birth in a particular body as okay, I'm going to do this now, you know. जैसे कि समझो किसी की बहुत एथलेटिक वासना होती है वगैरह, तो उसको भगवान एथलेटिक बनाएंगे, फिर उसकी बॉडी बड़ी स्ट्रांग ये वो होगी. जस्ट एन एग्जाम्पल. हाँ, सो ही सेइंग दैट समटाइम्स यू कैन गो टू अ पार्टी एंड देन यू रियलाइज, ओ आई एम वेयरिंग टोटली रॉन्ग क्लोथ्स. You know, maybe there was a theme and I got wore something totally opposite. So I may just say, no, I'm going to quit and go home and change and come back. You know, suddenly kisi ki death ho jati hai wagara. So we say, oh, why did this happen? Hey, he just felt like he needed to change his clothes. You know, I know it's very simplistic, but it is has a very deep reason behind it. That whenever, when this higher soul decides to quit, nobody can stop it. You know, it is up to him. So he was just saying that some people change clothes more often than others. You know, okay, I just want a short life. I want to finish everything and just go. Something to contemplate upon. And then he also said that in some traditions, they celebrate death. And he's saying that, Nikhilajanji was saying, I have not gone to those traditions, but and I actually Googled it. And I saw so many different tradition. They have different days that they do, like, I don't know, Hispanics or someone, they have like after 14 days, they do a celebration for the soul. No matter who dies, they want to celebrate their life, you know.
Umajita, I do it too. They have a wake after the death.
Yeah, right.
For days, they have eating, drinking and talking about the death.
Yes, yes. So when my brother passed away, my bhabhi called it, you know, celebrating his life, you know, when we went over there. And she didn't want us to be sitting and moping. You know, some obviously if somebody wants to cry and all, it's a different thing. But she wanted to take that approach that, hey, you know, he's done so much. He's been such a great person and we all want to remember him that way. That was a very positive thing. It helped us all, you know, to deal with our grief that way. So all that is done because life and death both are divine and we have to kind of accept that. And he's saying that you don't need to be jumping up and down, but you don't need to be like totally sad and keep crying about it. You know, that's what he was trying to say, to be practical about it, you know. So and then so this is what he talked about, Amritam and Mrityu. And then the last one is even deeper. And there are several different meaning, layers of meaning in it. He's saying that, Arjuna, I am Sat and Asat both. Okay. So now how do we understand this? So Nikhilananji took the approach of manifest and unmanifest, which is kind of easier way to understand. But when we go to Swamiji's commentary, we will understand that Bhagwan is above Sat and Asat because in that consciousness, we understand both. We understand I know and I what I don't know. It illumines both. It's like light and darkness. You know, the consciousness is above light and darkness because I understand in my consciousness, I understand both. I understand what is light and also what is darkness. You know, so that's a higher approach. So what is manifest and unmanifest? That's a little simpler way. Sat and Asat. Manifest means what we can grasp with our senses. So we have five senses. If I can see, hear, or either do all of it or some of it or one thing, doesn't matter. As long as my senses can grasp or one sense can grasp something, usko bolenge sat. मैनिफेस्टेड हो गया है. एंड अनमैनिफेस्टेड व्हेन इट इज एन अनमैनिफेस्ट फॉर्म लाइक यू नो व्हाट शुड आई से व्हेन वी टॉक अबाउट वाटर. सो व्हेन यू फ्रीज इट आई कैन सी अ फॉर्म लाइक अ आइस. सो इट्स मैनिफेस्ट ऑब्वियसली. And then I give a heat, keep giving heat. It still manifests, but it becomes a little more subtle, becomes water. Then I keep giving heat, and then it becomes, what you call, steam. And then it evaporates. Now it's become unmanifest for my senses. You know, but it's there. So you can look at it that way. Something which is there, but I can't see. Usko asat bola hai yahan. So Bhagwan ne kaha ki, main asat aur sat dono hoon. और या तो ऐसे सोचो या सोचो कि भगवान इज अबाव बोथ ऑफ देम व्हिच एवर वे यू वांट टू टेक इट. सो दिस इज व्हाट दिस वर्स इज अबाउट. इन दिस वे भगवान टॉक्स अबाउट दिस. बट निखिलानंद जी ब्रॉट अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट पॉइंट एंड आवर टीचर ओवर देयर इज टू स्ट्रेस दैट पॉइंट टू. दैट इज सेइंग दैट बिफोर टेकिंग द टॉपिक ऑफ भक्ति भगवान इन ऑल द डिफरेंट वेज इज टेलिंग हु ही इज यू नो. एंड व्हाई डिड ही हैव टू डू दैट. Because, you know, if you, I have mentioned this before, Nikhilanand ji had brought this point before also, saying that when somebody says to someone, I love you or I care about you so much, but if you don't know that person very well, you really don't love them. Even that person will feel, oh, you know, like he was just joking, you must have heard of this joke that a husband, you know, He tells his wife who is a housewife, huh? She's not. So he says, hey, what do you do all day? In his mind, you know, she's just wasting her time watching TV or something. And so every day he asks her, hey, what do you do? And she cannot explain to him what she does. And so one day she decides, you know, well, I'll say it in a more proper way. So one day he comes home and they had young children. So one day he comes home from work and the whole house is the biggest mess, you know. And it's like the children are crying, no, they have not taken bath and, you know, toys are lying everywhere, things are lying everywhere. He said, what's wrong, you know, kya tufaan aaya hai, yahan pe kya aaya hai? He said, okay, bring me dinner, I'm very tired. So she said, I didn't cook the dinner. So he got more mad. So he said, what do you mean? So she said, well, every day you ask me, what do you do, what do you do, what do you do? Today, whatever I do, I didn't do it. It's okay. That's why no food, the house is mess, children are not taken care of, nothing. So then he kind of appreciated. So what Nikhilanandji was saying, he can say, oh, I love my wife, but he really doesn't know because he has not taken the time to understand what she does or vice versa. If the wife doesn't know, you know, husband going to work and what he has to face and all, they think, oh, you just go for fun. Oh, no, he has to deal with his stuff. You learn each other's stuff. So that's what he was saying, that until you understand what that person is all about, make an effort to understand, you cannot love that person or respect that person fully. Exactly same thing Bhagwan is doing over here, that, you know, trying to make us understand him, appreciate what he does, and then our love will become complete. So then another angle he said, which we never think about, you say that when a person says, oh, Bhagwan, you know, I love you. And then they say, oh, I love God and all that. So then somebody will ask, okay, if you love God so much, why don't you study Bhagavad Gita? No, I don't want to do that, Baba. I go to the temple every day. I, you know, puja and all that. But I don't want to study Bhagavad Gita and all that. And I offer flowers, I chant my mantras, I'll do all that, and I take the prasad, I distribute it to everybody. Hey, great. But then you ask, so have you heard of Bhagavad Gita? So I think that at least most of the Indians have heard of it, right? Shayad koi ek do honge maha murkh, shayad wo log nahi suna hoga, I don't know. So, theek hai, suna hai Bhagavad Gita ke baare mein, acha padha usko, to... Or have you tried to study it? No, I'm not interested. So what Nikhilanand ji was saying, that you are not interested in that other person, you know, and you're saying you love them, but why don't you try to understand what he's saying about himself? Because Bhagavad Gita is one place that Krishna Bhagwan talks about himself, who God is. So he's saying that if you love Krishna, they say yes, but you don't want to listen to him. You don't want to hear what he's saying. I thought that was such a great point. So he's saying, Nikhilanandji was saying that Krishna Bhagwan is talking about himself, and that's what we need to be interested in. Okay, so this was a very strong point for studying Bhagavad Gita. And then he was just saying that how if you don't know about God, it's an incomplete love about God. Mm-hmm. So that's why he takes up this topic about hey, who God is before the bhakti comes. And then he was also reminding, now that we are studying Bhagavad Gita, he's saying nowhere in Bhagavad Gita, he said, I am just in this one form. Even when you say, oh, Krishna, 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 Krishna himself said, that's just the body of Krishna. I am everywhere. I'm in Ram also. I'm in Shiv also. So even that, you cannot get fanatic about that, you know, only one person. And then in nowhere in Bhagavad Gita, he says that I reside in a temple only. Hmm? If somebody get fanatic about the temple or a particular temple, you know, main to bas wahi hu, baki jagah main hai hu hi nahi. No, nowhere he said that. And then even a particular place, he didn't say that I only reside here. He always says I'm everywhere. I'm in everybody. Okay. So that's how you have to look at this identity, who he is. And then he's saying that one who understands this nature of God in this manner, you know, that person, when he does any kind of seva or expresses his love towards God, then it becomes a real puja, you know. Otherwise, it's just adhura. Adhura hai wo. It is incomplete. Okay. So this is what this kind of topic over here in this chapter about telling about God in the deepest manner is till this verse. And then one thing very interesting, the approach of Krishna Bhagwan is he doesn't leave anybody ki bhai agar tumko ye nahi samajhte the tum gaye kuch nahi kar sakte aisa kabhi nahi unhone ne bola jahan bhi tum ho wahan par wo unko help karenge, you know, tumhari journey mein tum kahin bhi ho. So the next group of people he talks about who have not understood this deeply about this, the way, you know, he's explaining. Suppose if it doesn't go into my head and, you know, I don't understand very what he's saying, but they still do some love and service towards him. Maybe incomplete, that's fine. So they may not do it as a real puja like even Nikhilanandji was saying, but they still do something, but they have a desire in their heart. You know, they may not have a complete understanding, but they still have, I meko ye mil jaye, wo mil jaye, worldly things they may want, or they may want, after I die, I should go to swarg loka. Aise bhi hota hai na. So, to gain some object in this world or after you die. So, then he talks about those kind of people and, you know, the rituals and all that they do and how, what kind of people they are and what do they gain, that he talks about in next two verses. You know, that we will do next time. So the trend in Bhagavad Gita is that he talks about the highest thing first. If you got it, fantastic. You don't have to worry about the other thing. Suppose if you didn't get it, go to step number two. Okay. And then you can understand the step number two and then evolve from there to step number one. So that's why when Arjun got all depressed and all that, and Krishna Bhagwan ne jab shuru kiya na usse baat karna, to usko sabse pehle highest knowledge diya, you know, that you are not the body and all that, and you are that Atman. And he talked about, you know, that imperishable Brahman and all that, and then he came down to all the different methods how to get there. So he did tell him the highest thing. So that's what it is. Any question, comment, or anybody wants to add anything to this verse? Okay, then we can read. Yeah, Neeluji, go ahead.
As sun, I give heat. I withhold and send forth the rain. I am immortality and also death. Both existence and non-existence, O Arjuna. To indicate that the self is the essence, not only in the equipments of worship and in the acts divine, but also that it is the ruling factor and the essence absolute behind all phenomenal objects and happenings in the universe, this stanza is given.
So the reason he said that, because in the last verse he said, no, last two verses there were mention of, hey, I'm the Om, I'm the, you know, all the Vedas and all that. You can look at it, those as a worship thing. But now he's saying phenomenal forces are, you know, the five elements of this, great elements of this universe. So he's the essence behind all of them. That's why it's, you know, tapamyaham. I give heat and I hold rain and I give rain. All that is part of the phenomenal objects. I mean, phenomenal elements, sorry. So that's what he's saying, essence behind the phenomenal.
I give heat. The electricity can rightly say that it gives heat in the heater, light in the bulb, cold in the refrigerator, because electricity conditioned through those equipments expresses itself in the manifestation as the above mentioned. Above mentioned heat, light and cold. Similarly, the self, the one existence, identifying with the phenomenon called the sun, becomes the source of all heat for the entire universe.
So I just want to mention one thing. When he says, I give heat, don't take the literal meaning only. Because heat has a very big meaning over here. Means giving the right amount of heat at the right time, taking it away, all that whole mechanism is done. And then even have to go beyond that. Like he was saying, the electricity passes through heater, gives heat. It passes through, air conditioning, gives cold, and passes through fan, gives air. So Bhagwan is behind every element. And according to our requirement, it's given or taken. In the bigger picture, we might say, oh, why did all these bad things happen in the earth and all that? So is it that I was just listening to one of, I think maybe somebody put it on our thing, or it's a known fact that people who go in the space, jab wo dekhte hai na space se hamari dharti ko, to unko ek unit dikhai deti hai. Aisa nahi lagta hai ki you're different देश हैं, लड़ रहे हैं, मर रहे हैं आपस में. उनको लगता है कितना सुंदर एक बॉल है और एक, और उसका जो एटमॉस्फेयर है ना, बोलते इतना डेलिकेट सा दिखाई देता है चारों तरफ. उनको लगता है कि लोग कितने बेवकूफ हैं कि जो कि इतनी डेलिकेट चीज को खराब करते जा रहे हैं. उनका विजन एकदम चेंज हो जाता है. उनको कोई वॉर नहीं दिखाई देता, कोई उनको एक ह्यूमैनिटी दिखाई देती है बस. So that's what it is, that we have to look at it from a higher perspective. Then we understand these verses much more,
I withhold and send forth rain. Not only do the modern meteorologists understand the influence which the sun has upon the climate conditions of the world, but the great rise...
Rishi. It's Rishi.
Oh, Rishi. But the great Rishis of old too had a perfect knowledge of the ways and behaviors of nature and had well understood that the position, condition, and nature of the sun determine the climate that comes to bless, of course, the world. The influence of the sun controls the fields of experience of every living creature on the globe, since it controls the climate conditions. If the sun were to send out a few more degrees of heat, the entire flora and fauna of the world must change. So too will be the transformation, complete and total, of the entire look of the world. If the sun were to withhold even a few calories of the heat that it is emitting out now, immediately there would be a march from the North Pole and the South Pole towards the equator, driving men and beings towards the central belt of the globe, causing more intense sorrows of overpopulation and lack of sufficient food.
So Swamiji just made it a little more dramatic in this. All he's trying to say that sun controls the climate on this earth, period. And sun is the whole heat and everything that sun has is coming from that Bhagwan only. So in turn, Bhagwan hi sab kuch kar rahe hain. Aur agar thoda bhi idhar udhar ho jana, because hum log kitna complain karte hain, magar wo bolte the ki thoda hum log ko jaise parents hote hain na, इंडिया में तो थोड़ा थप्पड़ वप्पड़ भी मार देते हैं, यहाँ पर हम लोग वो सब नहीं कर सकते, डांटेंगे खाली, टाइम आउट, लाइक माय ग्रैंडसन विल से डैडी जी टाइम आउट, ही अंडरस्टूड नाउ टाइम आउट बिजनेस. व्हाई सो व्हेन द नेचर स्लैप्स बैक एट अस बाय ऑल दीज थिंग्स, यू नो, मे बी फैमिन और वट एवर इट इज, टू टीच अस अ लेसन, दैट्स हाउ आई लुक एट इट, बिकॉज वी आर द वन हु रुइनिंग एवरीथिंग, यू नो, नॉट लिसनिंग एंड डूइंग बैड स्टफ. But Bhagwan is maintains the balance on this earth. We should know it extremely well. Because if it was just nature, to thoda bhi idhar udhar hoega, to sab disaster ho jayega earth ke upar. That's what he's trying to tell us. Okay?
These imaginary possibilities are here indicated only to help the student realize the scientific truth that is at the base of this passage, which a modern man, in his vanity of knowledge, might ignore as a poetic exaggeration. It is to be noted very carefully that the rishis express even scientific truths in their instinctive language of poetry in all our ancient literature. Nowhere else in the world had any people ever tried in the history of mankind to express precise sciences as physics or chemistry, medicine or mathematics in metrical compositions of the Aryans had done.
So basically Swamiji is telling us that through this word, some people might think, oh, you know, Bhagwan is saying he holds rain. If you look at it just as a poetic exaggeration, you're not going to get much out of this verse. But there is a scientific truth behind it. That's what he's trying to say. And it's a known fact ki in the olden days, science and spirituality were in one box. You know, they did not separate it. So, jitne bhi humare Vedas hain, jitna bhi different science hai, wo part of Vedas hi hain. Athar Veda mein wo pura dhanush ka gyan aur how to make a plane and how to do this. And I don't know all the details, but all that science is part of the Vedas also. Ayurveda is part of Vedas only, right? All those things. So he's just saying that in the whole world, in India, or I mean in this culture, Sanatan Dharma, is science and spirituality is together. And all the scientific facts, mathematics, this, that, everything is part of this only. All the verses, sometimes, you know, because of internet now and WhatsApp and all that, YouTube actually. I read a very interesting thing, maybe I'll post it, that how calculus was, certain principles of calculus were already discovered by the Indian rishis, you know, and they gave exact date, name, so anybody has a doubt can go further research. He gave all the names and all that. And then he took the verses and he analyzed the verses, what it was saying. It is like almost like a coded language. You know, even this Bhagavad Gita is in a subtle language. Simple thing like I give heat. There's a lot more in that two words. You know, I give three words. I give heat, because there's a whole science behind it, what it means. So that's how we have to look at it.
I am immortality and also death. If life were not illuminating experiences, it would become meaningless and purposeless. And the self, being the spark of life, is the essential stuff that gives a realistic experience of existence to the very phenomenon of death. To realize the self as the immutable and the eternal is to reach the state of immortality. Change is death, and therefore the phrase is to be understood as saying that the self is illuminator of change, itself ever the changeless.
So see, Swamiji took it to in a very philosophical and a deeper manner. Because Swamiji always says that when we say death, the real meaning of death is change in the world. And when we talk about change, you know, death of one thing becomes life for other thing. Because he gives the example of a plant. You know, you put the seed gets destroyed, seed dies and the tree comes up or plant comes up. And then the flower comes, the flower dies, fruit comes, right? Like that. So he calls it change in the world as death. But to understand that change, we have a changeless substratum. And we saw the scientific fact that change cannot happen unless you have a changeless thing behind it. So that changeless is that God, immortality, and the death is change, and both are illumined by the consciousness. You know, I don't know if I made myself clear what I'm saying, but just contemplate. If you have any questions, you can ask. But this is what how he's taking the approach of death and immortality.
I am the existence and the non-existence. To perceive and experience existence and non-existence, a positive illuminator of both is necessary. And the illuminating consciousness must be able to embrace both Sat and Asat. Sat and Asat in its all-comprehending knowledge. It is impossible to know and gain an experience of the total non-existence. Wherever we experience non-existence, we experience it as the non-existence that exists.
Okay, now this one, you guys might be totally confused. This is what he's saying. Okay, so there is something that I know, that everybody understood, right? Yeah, I know this, I know that, I know this table, I know you, I can see it. But how do you know something when you don't know? Okay, I know that I don't know. I know that I don't know Chinese language. Woh bhi toh mujhe samajh mein aaya ki nahin. So, Sat and Asat, dono ko main jaanti hu. Another example I will give. That, okay, we have the three experiences, you know, waking world, dream world, and then we have deep sleep, right? Waking world, we know extremely well because I'm, you know, dream also, we all know. Ki maine kuch dekha, phir main jaag gayi, and then I can remember that dream. Okay, I know about dream world also. What do you know about the deep sleep? If you have to define deep sleep, how will you say it? At that time, nothing was there. But I still know it or not, that nothing was there. Everybody has experience of deep sleep, but they can't define it because there was nothing there. But I still know that nothing is there. That's what Swamiji is trying to say, that in that conscious state, I understand both. So that's why from the highest perspective, he's Sat and Asat both. Whatever I don't know, also I know. And whatever I know, also I know. You know? So this is what he's saying. This is a very subtle thing. But, Meena ji.
It is, the existence is there. Therefore, I know that I didn't know anything in the deep sleep.
Okay, yeah.
Otherwise, I wouldn't have known that as well.
Exactly. So it's like I'm even capable of knowing what is something which is not there. Understanding that it is not there.
That's there. So that something had to be there to know that it was not.
Yes. It's the same thing like I understand darkness and light both.
Yes. Yeah.
Right? So I'm an illuminator of both. Because illuminator means understanding, being conscious of it.
I'm of both.
Yes. So I'm above it. That's why I know both. Yeah. That's how. That may be the best way to understand. Yeah.
Apart from the highly subtle philosophical interpretation claimed by the volcanic logic of the Vedantic, there is a simpler significance for the phrase. Sat and Asat are terms used in Vedanta to indicate the cause and effect, the unmanifest and the manifest, the self being that illuminating factor without which we can experience neither the unmanifest thoughts nor the manifest objects. The self eternal is conceived as the essence of both the manifest and the unmanifest. Without the mud, no pot is possible. With mud, all pots can exist. And therefore, the mud can claim, I am the pot of all sizes, shapes, and color.
So here, like just like Nikhilananji had explained, that manifest and unmanifest, which I explained to you, that cause and effect. And then, but the better example is this pot and mud. So, you know, mitti and pot. So these ghadas are made out of the mitti. So there's a potential ghadas in the mitti. Okay, unmanifest ghadas that, you know, literally infinite amount of different varieties can come out of a pot. If you ask an artist, how many types of ghadas can you make? He will say, jab tak main jinda hu, main roj naya naya bana sakta hu. There is no limit to it, right? This is all potential. So that's what he's saying, that at the highest level, you know, manifest and unmanifest, both are in that mitti only. That's what the mitti is saying. That's how, it's another contemplative subject, you know.
But what a nice example, though.
Yes, it's a very beautiful
example. Easy to understand example.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
This stanza can provide a lifetime inspiration to the meditators of their seat of contemplation while barreling their thoughts before shooting forth into the voiceless and nameless.
So Swamiji very poetically mentioned that, you know, these are the things versus who God is. You know, he started with, you know, I am your father, I am your mother. Those are very easy thing to understand, right? Then he got a little more subtle than a goal, and I am the sustainer. Wo bhi samajh mein aa gaya. Ye wala is pe kafi dimag lagana padega. Magar at least we got some tools, you know, with all the explanations of both the Swamis, we can churn upon it at what he means. Yeah. So that connecting line is there.
Those who devote themselves in the worship of the eternal with desires will come to their fulfillment. How?
So yeah, I was just saying that these are the people who may not understand the highest truth, but they still worship God. And, you know, I think that verse has already come that there are four different kinds of devotees, you know, Gyani and Arth and Artharthi and all that. And he's saying that all, sabhi mere bhakt hain. Tum mujhe mangne ko bhi aate ho na, theek hai, main dunga. You know, so that's how it is. But he's saying, meko Gyani sabse zyada pyara hai. He's the one who understands all these things. I love him the most. You know, it's like you have different kids and I know who have multiple kids, each one. So they will always have in the family, and tu sabse zyada laadli hai us maa-baap ki. Because maybe maa-baap saw some quality in this child, you know. So has a little extra softer heart, you know. So that's how it is. Anyway, any question, comment? कुछ तो बोलिए आप लोग
आपने इतना अच्छा एक्सप्रेशन कर दिया था बोलने के लिए बचाई
नो बट स्टिल यू नो सो कुछ भी नहीं है बोलने के लिए
अच्छे से एक्सप्लेन कर दिया
ओके देन आई विल क्लोज भगवद गीता हियर गो अहेड
आपने कहा था सो एंड सो हैज पास्ड अवे तो इंग्लैंड में व्हाट दे सेड वाज वन ऑफ माय कॉलीग्स हिज वाइफ डाइड सो वो फैक्ट्स में आया डेव्स वाइफ एक्सपायर्ड आई डिडंट अंडरस्टैंड कमिंग फ्रॉम इंडिया मुझे समझ में नहीं आया कि एक्सपायर का क्या मतलब सो आई वाज क्वाइट एंड दे ऑल सेड डू यू वांट टू सेंड फ्लावर्स टू डेव्स वाइफ हु हैज एक्सपायर्ड मुझे समझ नहीं आया कि व्हाई वुड
I think I have heard that term in bolte that person expired and the
expired.
Yeah, and I think the way we can from Vedantic perspective, uska jo life on earth thi na, uski expiry ho gayi.
Jisne aaya tha usne bola she has passed away.
Yes.
They
have different terms that they use. इंडिया में भी कितने टर्म्स है, सदगति उसकी हो गई, वो चला गया, ऐसे भी बोलते हैं ना, फलाना चला गया, यू नो, ऐसे जिस टोन में बोलेंगे तो पता चल जाता है कि दैट पर्सन.
वी फॉलो अ लॉट ऑफ द इंग्लिश टर्म्स एनीवेज.
वी फॉलो बट
सुना था
एक्सपायर्ड बर्ड, दैट पर्सन एक्सपायर्ड. एंड माई एक्सप्लेनेशन फ्रॉम वेदांतिक पर्सपेक्टिव है कि उसकी जो आयु की अवधि थी ना वो एक्सपायर हो गई, राइट. उस बोलते हैं ना कि फिक्स सांसें होती है या जब जब टाइम आ जाता है कि आई हैव टू लीव, सो टाइम एक्सपायर्ड एंड ही हैज टू टेक अनदर लाइफ नाउ. Okay, I'll just close Bhagavad Gita here. Sarva dharman parityajya mamekam sharanam vraja aham tva sarva papebhya moksha ishyami ma shuchah. Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Hari Om.